So, if you're investing in the stock markets, have you ever wondered what kind of companies, what types of companies should you invest in if your aim is to obtain a high expected rate of return on your investment? Well, I certainly have. How about you? Yes. Or to be more straight to the point, maybe you have wondered if it's possible to identify some predictors of future stock returns, some predictors that is variables that you might want to take into consideration when you are building your investment portfolio. And as you can imagine, as a finance professor, I get asked that question a lot, and especially as a finance professor who does research in the behavior of asset prices. So, for example, at a social gathering, and I meet a new person, someone whom I don't know from before, and eventually, after some chit-chat, they ask me, okay, so what do you do for a living? And I tell them, I'm a finance professor, and I study stock markets and the determinants of investment returns. And that's often met by a short silence, after which I then get the question that I'm so used to nowadays. And it's like, you know, oh, that's very interesting. So do you have any investment tips for me? I mean, should I maybe invest in Tesla right now? It seemed to have been a great investment, at least in the past. What should I do right now? So yeah, those are tough questions that we face, we finance professors. So being an academician, maybe it's a good place here to ask, what does finance research actually tell us about the predictability of future stock returns? And when I'm talking about predictability, I'm referring to our ability to assign different companies into different categories, those having high expected rates of returns and those having low expected rates of returns. And when I talk about high expected rates of returns, companies within that group, if you're able to identify those, it doesn't mean that companies within this group will always outperform the other companies in terms of future returns. But on average, expectation-wise, during a longer period, that should happen in that case, if we have some predictive power. And the question then really is, can we do that? Is it maybe so that there's no way to do such an assignment? There's no way to make any claims about the expected rate of return, the magnitude of future returns for any given companies, so that there's no predictability at all in the relative returns across different assets. And if that's the case, if that's what research tells us, then maybe the choice of individual companies into your portfolio is inconsequential for the expected rate of return on your portfolio. And in that case, the best idea would simply be to diversify as much as possible, to pick companies from stocks from different sectors, from different industries, from different countries. And then in the end, you would end up holding a well-diversified portfolio. And the expected rate of return, and also the realized rate of return that you would then get, is the same expected rate of return that the general stock market will be providing to investors. So that's one possibility. So no predictability at all, no possibility to put these companies in different groups. Or maybe, just maybe, it is possible to find some characteristics, some firm-specific characteristics that appear, at least in past data, to be connected with higher future return. And a firm-specific characteristic could, for example, be the company's age. How many years ago the company was founded? That's a variable, it's different for each firm, and we call that a characteristic, just as an example. And the idea then is that if you're able to maybe find those characteristics of firms that predict higher future stock returns, then if you build a portfolio that consists of firms having those types of characteristics, then maybe that portfolio is more likely to outperform than underperform some other portfolios. So, to set the stage, let's go back to traditional finance theory, developed back in the 1950s, 1960s, and 1970s. The basic tenet in that theory, and also in many modern theories, of course, is that the expected rate of return and risk go hand in hand. So yes, it is possible maybe to create a portfolio having a high expected rate of return, but there's a cost connected to that, and that cost is the riskiness of that portfolio. So high expected rate of return is a reward of the risk that you are taking. So that's the traditional idea. And furthermore, in this framework, if you assume well-functioning asset markets, it should be almost impossible to systematically, in the long run, create investment portfolios that would offer you abnormal returns. Now, what is an abnormal rate of return? Well, that's a rate of return that is too high, systematically too high, compared to the riskiness of that portfolio, of your investment. That would be an abnormal rate of return. So, in a traditional theory, you could say that expected rate of return, risk, go hand in hand, and there are no free lunches in the economy, because there's a cost involved with that high expected rate of return. And then we need an asset pricing model that gives you the commensurate rate of expected return as a function of the riskiness of that investment. And the first example of an asset pricing model is the capital asset pricing model developed by Will Sharp and some other researchers back in the 1960s. And without going into any details, this model tells you that, okay, you can measure, estimate something known as a beta parameter for each different investment, for portfolios, for different stocks. And then the higher the estimated beta parameter is, the higher is also the systematic risk of this investment, and the higher is the expected rate of return. So the traditional view would then say that expected rates of returns are one-dimensional on stock markets. It's governed, according to Capem, by one parameter, the beta. And these expected rates of returns, what that you can predict different stocks to have, they don't vary that much across stocks, because betas do not vary that much across stocks. That's an empirical result. However, modern finance has actually found another types of results that are in straight conflict with what you earlier thought about the stock markets. So nowadays, researchers would say that the expected rates of returns are actually, they are multidimensional. They seem to be stemming from many different sources. And there are a magnitude of variables that actually predict those future returns on different assets and different stocks companies. And the expected return variation across individual companies is much, much larger than what we thought back in, let's say, the 1990s and 1980s. So there appears to be, as mentioned, a magnitude of firm-specific characteristics that predict future returns on stocks. So here's just some of those examples. Now, if you look at the profitability of a company, look at the past 1 year profitability of different companies. What we tend to find in the data is that for the upcoming year, after these profitability numbers have been published to the markets, those companies that have been profitable in the past tend to have higher returns going forward, stock returns going forward, than companies that have been unprofitable. Or another finding is that if you look at the total assets, the last line in the balance sheet of companies, those companies that have expanded a lot. So during the past year, their total assets have increased in the balance sheet. They've expanded a lot. Those companies tend to do much worse in the future with respect to stock returns than companies that have actually not grown by that much. And if you look at past returns, do past returns predict future returns? Well, to some extent they do. So if we are now living at the beginning of May, and we look at returns in the previous month, that would be April in that case, then stocks that did very well in April, in the previous month, tend to do much worse in upcoming months than stocks that did badly in the previous month. If you then extend the time horizon, when we look back, to 1 year, you will tend to find that stocks actually that have had higher returns than other companies during this 1 year period, tend to continue having high returns in the future. And vice versa for stocks that have had low returns, but they tend to continue having low returns in the future. And if you then look at a 5 year horizon in the back, okay, then stocks that did well during the past 5 years in terms of stock returns, they tend to do much worse than stocks that did badly during the previous 5 years. And the list goes on and on and on. These are just some examples, but what we will find here is basically that when you look at literature, what we find is that there have actually been more than 300 variables that predict these stock returns. 300 firm-specific variables. Those are just some examples of those. So you know, the view that we have on financial markets nowadays is quite the opposite of what we were teaching our students back in the early 1990s. Or, well, I wasn't teaching back then, but maybe some of my more mature colleagues were doing that. So, yes, 300 predictive variables, that sounds like a lot, and it is a lot. So right now in the finance literature, there's like a mopping up operation going on. So, of course, many of these predictability findings are probably just, you know, false discoveries. We have thousands of researchers, or even more practitioners, combing over the same old data sets, trying to find predictability there. And of course, just by chance, you will always find something there. And the real question is then, okay, so which one of these findings are false discoveries? What firm-specific characteristics should we base our investment advice on? And really, it says, what are the economic stories behind this predictability? Is it due to maybe some human errors in our judgment that these stocks are mispriced, underpriced, for example, measured by characteristics, and that's why they have high returns in the future? Or could something else be going on? And of course, it could be possible that these characteristics are connected to risk sources, some risks that we don't understand yet. And then the high expected rate of return based on the characteristics that the stock has is just, some functional risk that we end up having in our portfolio. Okay, here's just one example based on one of our published research. And what we do here, just to show you the wide variation in expected returns and predictability here, what we do here is that we use 55 of those characteristics uncovered in previous literature, and we create trading strategies based on them. Okay, so we measure characteristics, let's say at this time point here, and then we put it to high expected return groups, 300 to 500 of those stocks having had, so to say, the highest characteristics that have such values that they would predict high returns for this stock. And then we do the same for the 300 to 500 stocks having had such characteristics that would predict low returns for these stocks. And then we hold these portfolios for 1 year, and you can see that, okay, in historical data, before trading costs are taken into account, it would actually have been a fairly good trading strategy. So the group of stocks that we would predict would have higher returns in the future actually have produced a 12% rate of return, and the low group has produced only a 2% rate of return. So it's like a 10% return difference on an annual basis on average. So there appears to be a lot of predictability. And not only is there a lot of predictability, appears to be a lot of predictability in these future returns across stocks. What we've also found in one of our research is that there's also time variation in these expected rates of returns. And this seasonality is also calendar month predictability. So if you take a stock that has had high returns, that basically has a high expected rate of return, it's not so, in general, that the high expected rate of return will then accumulate during each calendar month, but there tends to be systematic patterns here. So maybe some stocks have high returns in May, some other stocks have high returns, let's say, in September. Some stocks tend to have low returns in January. Some other stocks tend to have low returns in April, for example. So a good trading strategy, once again before trading costs are taken into account, is that if you're now living at the beginning of May, once again, then you look at historical data, you calculate the historical May returns for each company that you might want to invest in, and then you invest into those companies having had the highest historical May returns, let's say 10 years back in time, and you keep the portfolio for the upcoming May month. So that would actually have produced, once again in past data, to fairly high returns to this training strategy. So the stylized fact is that there's lots and lots of variation expected returns between stocks, and also that there's predictable time variation is expected rates of returns. However, in one of our more recently published papers, we actually take the opposite view based on data. It's almost like a shot through the heart of current academic knowledge, because we argue that, hey, there's actually almost no variation in expected rates of returns across stocks. How is that possible? How can we make that claim? Well, it depends on the time horizon you're looking at. So past research has mostly studied, you know, one month returns ahead in time, or a maximum of 1 year returns ahead in time when you talk about predictability. But what we find here is that, okay, in a longer term, going to year two, year three, if you hold this portfolio position long enough, it tends to be the case that these expected return differences, they die out. There is no predictability expected returns if you have a long enough time horizon into the future. And one reason for that is actually, it doesn't explain fully this pattern that we find here, but one reason is that firms tend to change over time. A firm might have such characteristics that predict high returns in the future today. It might have been profitable in the past, it might have had high 1 year returns in the past, but after a couple of years, that firm is not likely to be as profitable as it was. This reversion towards the mean as it was some years ago. And of course, its returns it's not likely that the returns have continued to be as high as they were when it created its portfolio. So on average, the firms are get closer to each other in terms of its characteristics, implying, of course, that their expected rates of returns also get closer to each other. So, now, it's time to go back to the question posed at the beginning. And that question was, okay, so how should you then invest based on this advice? So when I've told those new acquaintances, you know, at the social gatherings, okay, about this stuff. So let's collect some facts. Is there predictability in future stock returns? Well, probably not to the same extent as has been found in historical data, but I would believe that there is still enough evidence to say that yes, there is at least some kind of predictability there. Of course, some of that predictability might be due to false findings. Okay, just because there's been some data snooping going on in the past. Okay, so what characteristics should you take a look at when you want to create your portfolio? That's actually a tough question. Also, we don't simply know yet with enough certainty, so I could give you some investment advice based on that, as individual investors at least. After 10 years, maybe. After 20 years, maybe. And, so you do still need to diversify if you want to follow these characteristic-based trading strategies. It's not enough, and this is an important point, it's not enough that you invest in just one company having a characteristic that would predict high returns for this company, because it's an average effect. You can see this effect in, you know, large sets of companies, let's say 300 companies that have such a characteristic. On average, this predictor will predict high future returns for that group. But if you just invest in one company, then you basically just make company-specific bets. There's a lot of firm-specific effects happening there. And you're not really capturing the predictive power which you would get from this characteristic, because you need a well-diversified strategy to do that, to get rid of that idiosyncratic firm-specific risk that is connected there. And finally, do you need to rebalance your portfolio often? Well, fairly often. So you saw our results about how long this predictability will last. So if you want to follow these kind of strategies, you first need to invest in actually several hundreds of stocks, at least 50, rebalance the portfolio fairly often, and for, you know, regular small investors, individual investors, that's probably not something, I mean, you want to do. There's a lot of trading costs going on there. It's still uncertain what will happen in the future. So if you're just a stock picker, picky stocks, you know, investing into individual companies, then you're probably not losing much by ignoring much of this predictability that the characteristics have. The most important thing, once again, is that you build a diversified portfolio, and maybe passive portfolio, invest maybe in some mutual funds, ETFs, and then you get the mean stock market return, which probably should be good enough for you. The story is different, of course, for institutional investors who have great trading algorithms and stuff like that, but maybe not for individual investors. And of course, I know it sounds boring, doesn't it? But keep in mind that good investing is often boring. Thank you.